original papers were explicitly told not to mark the Ireland 2040 content as an ad. So how do you think editors should have responded to that request from the government?
No, it's easy. I mean, this is not a complicated question. The difficulty in keeping news and editorial content separate from advertising has been a problem for 300 years. It's still a problem. And to direct a news organization to disguise paid advertising as news is unconscionable from the government's perspective and easy from the editor's perspective, which is no. If you buy space, then you can say whatever you wish within the limits of good taste and the law in the paid space that you have bought. Otherwise, you don't have anything to say about what goes in the news content. That's our job. You got your job to do, and we got our job to do, and they're very different jobs. And it is inevitable that people in government would like to manage the news. It doesn't make them bad people, necessarily, but it does mean that we can't let them do that for all the reasons that we have a free press. I mean, once government gets to start saying, here is copy, it's an ad, or it's an order from the government, and you are to disguise it as news, then we don't have journalism anymore, then we're doing PR for the government. And that's a different animal.
So Leo Varadkar's defense was that the papers would have covered this content anyway. Do you think that's a valid excuse? And do you think the money exchanging hands definitely influenced the copy?
Well, no, he doesn't get to say what the papers would cover anyway. That's not his job. We can cover what we choose to cover, and we can not cover what we choose to not cover. And he has nothing to do with that and must not have anything to do with that, even if he's charming and well-spoken. He doesn't get to do that. That's not his job. Now, concerning whether if we bought an ad, does that mean we are going to have an influence on the news copy? It shouldn't. It's very difficult to maintain that wall between advertising and editorial, but it's vital that we continue to do so, and it's vital that we try to do so, and it's vital that we not say, well, as long as you're taking an ad, we will cover the airline industry any way you like, and we'll never mention air disasters, and we'll say everybody's happy at Aer Lingus. They are different things. And no, he's just as wrong as he can possibly be in saying that we get to determine news copy because we're taking out ads, and therefore our money is buying not just news stories, not just ads, but influencing news copy. And so we might as well be efficient and just sort of write the copy ourselves. No, that's not true. I mean, he can't do that. He shouldn't be allowed to do that.
So obviously the financial climate for traditional papers particularly, they're in a difficult position at the minute. So do you think it was just too difficult to say no, or do you think that should not have gotten in the way of editorial decisions?
Once it becomes too difficult to say no, I would love to do the right thing, but I can't afford to do the right thing, at that point you quit. You go into PR or something that's far less honorable, like law, and you quit trying to pretend you're a journalist. I mean, all we have is our credibility and our sense of integrity. And once we say we cannot afford to be honest journalists anymore, then we cannot afford to be journalists anymore, and we give it up when we go do something else for a living.
So obviously, though, if you're in a newsroom and your editor has come in and said that you have to write this and it is sponsored content, how does the journalist handle that decision?
Well, I've done that twice, not on sponsored content, but on orders from the publisher to write these, to write this story instead of that story. And I have, in personal experience, had that happen twice. I've said no, and in one case I went looking for a job, and in the other case I didn't. So, no, you don't always win, but it's, if this stops being a calling, then it's not worth doing as a job. And sometimes you have to do, sometimes you get told to do things that you cannot, in God, in good conscience, do. And then you have a choice. And I have probably been fortunate in that I was never going to lose my home. My wife was working, and you know, we were living modestly enough so that we could live without a paycheck for a few weeks if it came to that. It did come to that. We didn't starve. So whether everybody can do that, I don't know, but I think everybody should. I think if you're going to start selling what you do, then I think you ought to get a whole lot of money for it, because you can't sell it again. It's pretty straightforward to me, and I have found editors to be generally receptive to the argument, no, this is not honest journalism. I'm not going to do this. And I know that you want me to. And I know that you feel if you tell me to, I will. I won't. There was a time, boss, when you got into this business for idealistic reasons. I have to hope there is still some fragment of that still within you. But that's not my problem. I will not do this if I shouldn't. If it's not as honest a journalistic job as I can do, then no, I won't do it. And whatever happens, happens. We got pretty good unions in this country, and it's very hard to fire people for doing the right thing, for sticking up for integrity, for being on the side of the angels. And if you lose, you lose. It's not the end of the world. Once you lose your integrity, that you can't get back. And that, I think, it seems naively idealistic. I have been as naively idealistic as I could be since I got into this business in 1964. And still am. And it still works, most of the time. It doesn't always work. So you cave this time, and you do what you're told to do, and it's not the right thing to do. And the next time you're told to do something worse. And the next time you're told to make something up entirely. And the next time you're told, don't bother writing this story because he's a friend of the publisher. At what point do you quit? You don't. So you hold the line on being as honorable as you can possibly be. And there you are. And not everybody goes with that. And I think that's too bad. But that's how I work. And that's how I try to encourage other people to work. And it works pretty well.